all members of council here. I'm looking to the clerk if we can officially start. There's no national anthem or moment of reflection. This is a special council meeting. Welcome everyone to this special meeting of council. This meeting is called for the single purpose to consider post-secondary education in the city of Brampton. Under council's meeting rules, no other business can be considered at this special meeting. So if a council member is excited to talk about something else, you can't, which is lovely. We have a motion moved by Councillor Santos, seconded by Councillor Willens, to approve the agenda. All those in favor of the motion? Motion carries. Do any members have a declaration of pecuniary interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act for any matter to be considered on today's agenda? Seeing none, the clerk will so note for the meeting minutes. Our next item is presentation item 3.1 regarding post-secondary education. This evening, we will welcome the following post-secondary education institutional presidents who will be presenting to council: Asma Vezina, the president of Algoma University; Mohammed Lashmi, president and vice chancellor of Ryerson University; Janet Morrison, the president and vice chancellor of Sheridan College. So we have some academic heavyweights here tonight. After their presentation, there will be an opportunity for questions from members before we consider this matter. And let me just start off by saying, on a positive note, about a year ago, I think, a year and a half ago, all of us were pretty dismayed when we heard the news about the province pulling out from the Ryerson project. And we all said we weren't going to be deterred. The city deserved more academic options. And it seems like a different world today, a year and a half later, where there is so much interest from a multitude of fronts. And that's a good thing. It creates a conversation that puts students first. And with that, we welcome this presentation in the spirit of a positive environment right now in Brampton, when we're not looking at what needs to be shut down, but what opportunities exist. So welcome Presidents Vezina, Lashmi, and Morrison.
Good evening. We will be doing the presentation, the three of us. That's why we are here. First of all, Mayor Brown, members of council, thank you so much for giving us an opportunity to talk about some bold ideas that we want to share with you. What we want through the discussion, and I see it more the dialogue than just presentation, is really to offer some solutions to some of the pressing issues that we are facing in society. Of course, Brampton is going to play a major role, but the way that we are presenting this city to help our province and our country address issues by providing solutions through post-secondary education here in Brampton. The title of our presentation is United for Brampton, and I think it's a good message from the three institutions that we should work together for a better, bold Brampton. And what we want really to focus in tonight's presentation is about how can higher education, both from the university and the college sector, help the city of Brampton and the region drive economic prosperity for the city and the region, but also solve problems. And actually, this is the main aspect of the discussion tonight. What's our vision for Brampton? First of all, let's look at the issues that we are facing as a society. And also, when we talk about training and education, we are focusing on providing society with the necessary skills and talent that will help solve the problems. So talking about talent, what are the needs? Because if we are talking about a presence of post-secondary, or a robust presence of post-secondary education in Brampton, we should look at areas where there's a huge need for talent. I would invite you to read an article that was actually just published this morning in the Toronto Star about the gap in talent. And actually, that was an excellent article giving us an overview about the current situation, but also the needs for talent for the entire region, the GTA. If you read the article, and it's a long article, they talk about three specific areas where there's a huge gap in talent. The IT, and I think that's part of what we want to propose here. So the IT sector, everybody's looking for experts in IT. The second one is healthcare. And we know the challenges that are faced by the city of Brampton and also our province. And the third one, actually, they're talking about construction. We are not going to propose anything about construction. But for your information, I'm a civil engineer. Construction need more technology and IT. We don't need more construction workers. We need to really renovate or innovate the construction sector. So the ideas that we are going to share with you tonight is also offering solutions not only for Brampton, but we want you and us, when we talk to the provincial government, to the federal government, that we can also propose something that can be a pilot project for the entire province. And this is why we're talking here about a partnership between the north and the south. And when we looked at the issues that are you are facing in Brampton, we have the similar situation with communities in the north. So if you can use this corridor, a lot of people are talking about the corridor Toronto, Waterloo, and this is why first thing when we came to Brampton is really to be at the mid distance of the two cities, Brampton and, Waterloo and Toronto. But also a lot of people are talking about the corridor north-south and how this can help Brampton position itself to solve problems. And I think in terms of the political situation, because we know that the mayor has mentioned about the decision by the government to cancel the campus here in Brampton, that decision was for three campuses, three universities and three colleges. So we want also to present a solution in this case, saying that this is not just about Brampton, this is about our province. And I think the government would be very interested. So the three themes that we are proposing here is making sure that we grow information technology jobs with a focus on areas of extremely importance to society, cybersecurity, and cyber science in general. And we already started working on that aspect. You have here a National Center now for Cybersecurity. Sheridan is offering degree programs in the area, but we want really to do more. The second one is the issue that is faced by all of us in Ontario is the issue of mental health, addiction, and also the problem of opioid crisis that is unfortunately affecting all of us in different parts of the Ontario or the province of Ontario. The third part, which is actually extremely important, is to address the issue of hallway healthcare by growing system capacity and focusing on digital health innovations. So basically, this is why we are here to talk to you about those three aspects. Now we can talk about the current situation in each of the institutions.
Thank you, Mohammed. So as a segue to talking about what we think the power of synergy and collaboration is, we thought each of us would just take a moment to underscore what we would bring to the table. And I'm very conscious that all of you are well familiar with Sheridan. Sheridan is certainly well known to Brampton. We've been an anchor institution in the city for over 50 years. And although we were founded in 1967 with the same mandate as other Ontario colleges, I think civic and industry leaders in the city will know well that we've evolved dramatically. And we continue to change and to grow in response to economic demand in particular. So building on the best of our history, and as I was really pleased and proud to report to council when I was here late last year, we've worked to incorporate the best component pieces of colleges, polytechnics, and universities to architect a new composite and visionary form of higher education that again drives economic and social outcomes. So just by way of reminder, each year we enroll about 12,000 students at our Davis campus. And since 1995, Sheridan has launched over 62,800 graduates from its Brampton campus. We have 33,000 Sheridan graduates living in Brampton today, And 257 of our graduates actually work at the city of Brampton. I'm sure that's what makes the city run so well. Our Davis campus employs 417 full-time employees. And of our full-time faculty cohort in Brampton, just by way of quality assurance, 33% of those faculty hold PhDs and 50% hold master's credentials. So Sheridan offers 26 four-year honors baccalaureate degrees, which combine theory and critical thinking, somewhat typical of a university program, with hands-on applied learning and a practical work term. And those degrees at Brampton or offered in concert with Brampton locations include engineering, mobile computing, cybersecurity, supply chain management, community safety, and kinesiology and health promotion, just to name a few. We also offer 100 other credentials, including diploma programs in allied health professions like social services, practical nursing, personal support worker, and pharmacy technician, which I think is germane to the conversation we're having today. Fully 25% of our students already have an undergraduate university degree when they enroll, and 85% of our students indicate that they're more than or satisfied that they've gained the knowledge and skills that will help them in the future, in their future careers. Just a couple of comments about our connectivity and our investment in Brampton. In the last 3 years, 164 Brampton companies have hired Sheridan students into more than 500 co-op and internship positions. And every academic year, over 765 organizations across Brampton benefit from the experiential learning services of our field placement students. We have 6 research and incubation centers, all of which fuel applied research, social innovation, entrepreneurship, training and learning. One of those research centers is found here at our Brampton campus, the Center for Advanced Manufacturing and Design Technologies. It was founded with a $2.5 million investment from the city of Brampton. It features a fleet of ABB robots, prototyping tech, as well as highly sophisticated commercial grade equipment for additive manufacturing, 3D printing, and circuit board printers. We're also home to the Center for Mobile Innovation, which we're going to talk about more later. It's attracted more than $3 million in funding for innovative projects. The center pairs students and faculty with industry partners like Minder Mobile, a company that builds apps that provide peace of mind for people living with chronic health conditions like asthma. Finally, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention our Entrepreneurship Discovery Growth Engine, or EDGE, which is focused on supporting startups and scale-ups in Mississauga and Brampton. And I just close by noting that our student performance or student key performance indicators are some of the highest in the province, which we see as a testimony to our full suite of student support services. I'm now going to pass it over to my colleague Asma, who's going to talk about Algoma.
Good evening, everyone. So in terms of Algoma University, our story begins about 10, well, actually it's about 11, 12 years ago now in Brampton, where we were running a college pathway program in business. And then about 2 years ago, when I started as a president, the community asked me what was my vision for a university in Brampton. And I had to really think about that. So we went out and we started to talk to the community about what was happening with the Vision 2040, what they were hoping that Algoma might do, and what some of the needs of the city were. And probably about a year later, we launched the School of Business and Economics. And so the School of Business and Economics, which I've presented before, has 3 program focus areas: human resources, business, and economics. It also has a finance degree, and we're in the process of bringing an MBA program with an international partner. The School of Business has been wildly successful. I don't think anyone could have imagined the success that we would have experienced there, and we are just getting ready for a ribbon cutting where we'll celebrate the new building that it's in, or the new area that's been renovated. Just shortly after that, we had conversation with you as a council, and some of the conversation was around the possibility for expansion. And so we started to talk about what that phase 2 of an expansion might look like. And in talking with the city staff and a number of partners again, and looking at a lot of the research that had been done around gaps in the community for talent, we came up with the Center for Social, Cultural, and Economic Innovation. And so we're just starting to build that center now and bringing in 4 to 6 new degree programs. Right now, slated, we've got psychology, law, community economic social development, environmental studies. And we're looking to bring, and you'll hear a little bit more about that in a bit, a master's in clinical psychology and a master's in social work. So those programs are under development right now. What that center is going to do is it's going to take real challenges that the community is facing. Might be in environmental science, could be in something specific to a social need. And we're going to work on that together with the community to try to solve some of these issues. And then finally, on Friday, coming to Senate, we're going to introduce a School of Computer Science and Technology. And that'll be on both of our campuses. Our computer science is our fastest growing program right now. Currently, we have gaming technology, and then we have gaming technology in the creative arts, and we also have mobile software engineering. And we are working very closely right now with Ryerson to develop a cyber science degree. So, and then the last piece of that is a master's in computer science, which is under development right now.
I'll be brief about Ryerson. We are considered one of the largest universities now in Ontario with 45,000 students. And most of our programs are really applied in nature, where we want to prepare students really to be ready for jobs and careers. I'll focus here about what we are doing so far here in Brampton. We are very pleased to see that the center, the National Center for Cybersecurity, CyberSecure, Catalyst has started the training program, and I think this would really have a major impact in terms of providing the industry and also public sector with the necessary talent to address the issue of cybersecurity. The training and certification program is targeting 2,200 professionals, and I think that's just the beginning of what the Cyber Secure Catalyst is going to do. We are very grateful to the support that we get from the City of Brampton. You have invested in the center $5 million. I think the investment return on investment, we secured $25 million from other partners. And the initial funding that we secured for Cyber Catalyst now is in the order of $30 million. The other thing that's very important for us is to use our expertise in entrepreneurship and innovation and implement the same type of thing that are working very well for us in downtown Toronto, but also in other places. You may know that we have a number of incubators here in Canada, but also in India and Vietnam. And we want really to work with the City of Brampton to keep your talent and your youth and give them the opportunities here to create their own companies, their own jobs, but create jobs for others. So we are also very proud of the collaboration and the partnership that we have with City of Brampton in creating an innovation, new innovation hub. In addition to that, we are starting in May a new accelerated program really to help startups that are already in the area of cybersecurity to increase their potential and open up more opportunities for them and also for the city of Brampton. We have also a large number of students at Ryerson from Brampton, and we understand the difficulty for them to navigate the system, and unfortunately we have a transit system in the GTA that is not functioning very well. We want also to provide support, local support, for even existing students, and we are in the planning phase of having a career center and tutoring and mentoring support for students that are in downtown Toronto, but we want them also to have that support here. Just to give you an example of the number of students that we have from Brampton, today we had Minister Sarkar visiting our campus, and he came to our library and he told me that he was stopped by many people from Brampton saying hello, because they saw him as, of course, championing Brampton in the provincial level. We want also, talking about healthcare, we want also to expand the programming that we have. We have a large faculty of community services dealing with all issues of healthcare, and I think it's very important for us to include all programming in allied health professions like nursing, psychology, child and youth work, and social work, and increase the collaboration with both Algoma and Sheridan, but also offering more programming here in the city of Brampton. And I can tell you that we are running at full capacity. We have the university that is receiving the largest number of applications per spot available. Our nursing program, if you don't have 93 from high school, there is no chance for students to get in. So we want also to give more opportunities. And we have, by the way, the largest nursing program in the country in terms of number of students. So we want also to work with the city of Brampton to open those opportunities for students in all the allied health professions. Oh, sorry, bring back.
So we wanted to move into the three areas now that we're thinking about for the future. And we've had to have some really sit-down conversations to say, where are we aligned in our thinking and where might we actually have an impact? And we started to realize that the three areas that have come out in this presentation tonight of where we would like to position ourselves in the future are three areas that all of the universities and the college are working on right now. And the beauty of this proposal is that it takes the best from each of the institutions and we work together to create something even better. And I think that's where we have the potential to have a real leadership impact, not only in the city, but I would say in the province, Canada, and the world. So we know cybersecurity is a huge issue for our country right now. Just to share a couple of stats, in terms of global cybersecurity, the market is projected to grow to $248 billion by 2023. We also know that the world is estimating a global skills gap of 3 million positions worldwide, and that's here right now. So we know we've got a huge talent shortage, but we also have a significant security threat that needs to be dealt with and it needs to be handled really, really well. And so one of the things that we've been looking at, Algoma and Ryerson are looking to launch a new degree collaboratively and reskilling programs that could be completed in as little as 6 months. We are looking at reskilling the current labor force, North, South, Brampton, Toronto. And we're also looking at longer programs. So the goal is to have students be able to ladder in, start from high school or reskilling. Maybe they're not working right now. Maybe the business needs to reskill their labor force to provide that opportunity here in Brampton for them. But also to be able to really move into degree programming, master's and PhD programming, as well as research and lots of innovation. The idea is that all the programs between the college and the two universities will leverage the strengths of existing degrees in their programs. And I'm going to get Sheridan to talk a little bit about their degree program because we have something pretty special already in this city. And then the idea of flexible programming so that it doesn't matter where you are in the system, you can move on. And the idea is to get some very quick talent into the system to address the shortage with a focus also on the experiential learning, on entrepreneurship and innovation and moving forward to get to fill the need of this particular gap area. Do you want to talk a little bit about Sheridan's
only to say that we have a four-year honors baccalaureate program already in cybersecurity. You'll appreciate that those graduates are hired long before they are finished the degree. Some of them in Brampton, so Loblaw, for example, is an employer of our students, but more often they're being pulled out just because of the competitive market that they are afforded. So they're working at CSIS, they're working for the RCMP, they're certainly hired by OPP and by local industry. But there's lots more we could do in this space, but we think leveraging the strengths of all three organizations to bolster our degree offerings in cybersecurity and mobile computing, two of our strongest offerings that also rely on our Center for Mobile Innovation. We think there's tremendous opportunity here to ramp quickly and deliver outcomes for the city and the province.
And we love that our students can be working between the institutions, and if we're sharing expertise, they might be taking a course at Sheridan, they might be taking a course at Algoma, they might go on to Ryerson to do their master's or their PhD, but it's that whole idea that the institutions are creating seamless opportunities for students no matter where they are in their learning. And what that does is, because the three institutions are focusing on that, if we look at goal three, one of our goals is to really establish Brampton's reputation as a cybersecurity capital of Canada. And we can see all kinds of things morphing out of that. New businesses coming to Brampton, hosting research symposiums, hosting all kinds of events in the city to give that profile that we're looking for. And you can see the other goals, and we've talked sort of to them already, so I won't go into them too much, but we were going to just touch on the Rogers Cyber Catalyst before going on.
I think in terms of the work that is done by the Rogers Cyber Secure Catalyst, you have seen that in 1 year, the work that is done here is recognized by many organizations, and having Rogers Communications, RBC, and the federal government supporting, it's a good indication. Most of the time, those people will wait until the work is done to come up with funding, but we're very pleased to see that from day one, they supported us. And actually, what is unique about this, why we think that there is no doubt in my mind that Brampton will be the center, the capital city for cybersecurity in Canada, and I think Brampton has the ability to be really a hub, in a global hub for cybersecurity. In the first year of operation of the Cyber Secure Catalyst, you have seen that the federal government, in the budget of last year, they have indicated that one of the four centers is the center in Brampton. That's very rare for the federal government to take a risk. Because we have many other centers that are doing the work, they mentioned UNB in Atlantic Canada, they mentioned Calgary, but having actually a specific direction about the work that's done here shows that there is a huge opportunity for Brampton to lead in terms of cybersecurity. Let's talk now about the aspect of Brampton as a center. We are using the term center. This is a dialogue that we want to have with you. You can call it different ways. You can call it campus, you can call it university, you can call it whatever you want. It's a Brampton Center for Health and Innovation. And here is why we want to talk to you about this. Because there is a huge problem with our healthcare sector. We have a system that is supported by everyone. If you look at surveys year after year, just the previous federal election, the number one problem for Canadians, I think we have two aspects that are interrelated, climate change and healthcare. And this is actually the opinion of the majority of Canadians. And healthcare is important for all of us, but the problem when you look at it from a fiscal situation is not sustainable. So there's a need for us to address this by providing solutions and use of technology. This is why our approach here is focusing on innovation in the healthcare. Now, there's also, we're talking about the importance of talent. There's also shortage of talent. And I'll just give you two, three numbers. You may have seen an article in the Globe just last Friday, I think it was Thursday or Friday, where they're saying, this is actually a survey that was done around the world. They're saying Canada falls behind other wealthy countries in number of doctors per capita. They looked at the top 10 countries around the world in terms of wealth. You know, Canada is number 10 in terms of number of medical doctors per capita. The number that we have is that we have 2.7 practicing physician per 1,000 people in Canada, compared to the top country, Norway, which is 4.8. So 2.7. The next country just behind us is the US, 2.6. I think we know that the US healthcare has two-tier system and all the issues. So comparing us to the US, we are almost at the same level. So there is an urgency for us to address the absence or the lack of talent that to address the healthcare situation in the country. I mentioned also the article in the Star today about talent. Here are two numbers, which is surprising. For the next 5 years, Ontario is in need of 20,000 nurses and 8,000 medical doctors. Can Brampton play a role in that? My answer is 100% yes. We should find a way to do it, but not do it the way that other medical schools are doing it. Of course, when we talk about the population here of GTA, we are the largest metropolitan area in North America with one single medical school. If you compare to other regions in North America with the number of medical schools, on average it's 6 to 7. And I'm not comparing to New York, I'm comparing to regions and cities of our size, Boston, Chicago, Philadelphia. So I think there's a need for us to do things differently and to offer services that are going to help all of us, including the government, to find solutions. And I don't have to spend time talking about the issue here. And I know that just 2 weeks ago, the mayor was in the media talking about the crisis that the hospitals here are facing, and that's a reality. I'm actually on the board for the Trillium Hospitals, and Mississauga and Etobicoke. We're facing the same problem. I don't think that adding more beds will solve the problem. Adding more beds will reduce a little bit of pressure, but it's about time for us to find solutions. Yes, I think we have to have a comprehensive solution to the problem. Yes, the government has to invest more, but also the government has to invest in solutions that can be can ensure that we have a sustainable system. And the numbers that we are sharing with you here, you are very familiar, so I don't want to spend more time talking about them. So this idea of Brampton as a center for health and innovation, we are proposing, this is, as I said, part of dialogue with you, that we will leverage innovation strengths to meet this public challenges that we are all facing, and to create a new center here in Brampton. That center will serve as point of origin for community-based clinical education. I think we have to move the pressure out of the hospitals. And you have here a very strong community that can be involved in that aspect. Interprofessional practice. You cannot solve problems just from one angle. This is why we are talking here about a very comprehensive and holistic approach. I know that one of the issues that you are facing in Brampton is diabetes. Diabetes has to be tackled by many professions in the area, nursing, social work, nutrition, food and nutrition, and so on. And this is why we want really more collaboration between the three institutions to get really to the point where we can solve some of those problems. The other aspect that we are proposing, integration of technology into practice. Unfortunately, our sector, especially the health sector, we are still using very old practices. It's about time to us to use virtual technologies to help people. And I think this is the proposal that we are talking here can really be part of the solution. The other thing that is very unique to Brampton is we need to include in our training programs and education programs the importance of paying attention to different cultures. This is why in our approach to healthcare, we did not want to talk about it in the context of downtown Toronto. I think it's important to talk about this in the context of the 905, but Brampton could be really a pilot for it. We have a large number of people coming from different cultures. It's about time to have culturally competent training that is incorporated in what we want. So outcomes of the center. We want to increase the capacity in the William Osler Health Network by increasing the supply of qualified health professionals. And we're talking here about many of the programs that we are doing. Center for next generation of health technology innovation and job creation in Brampton. Third, ensure that the healthcare professionals in Brampton have the competencies to serve families from a diverse background. Our goals is to work together in a very holistic way, really to address the needs of the region and of the city. Develop new community accessible clinical space and cross-cultural resources and support for diverse communities accessing the healthcare system. Establish a community health zone for innovation and scale up of companies focused on digital health solutions. We have a good expertise with St. Mike's Hospital in downtown Toronto, and I can tell you by bringing people from different disciplines, including engineering, science, and so on, working with clinicians, we have seen many examples of startups that are really now helping solving the problem. And it's about time to think about a new way of doing medical education, and we think that Brampton can be that hub to get the next generation of medical schools here in Brampton.
So we're going to change the world. We wanted to talk to you a little bit about a mental health and addictions focus as well. And again, just to share some of the statistics, and we saw the city tweeting all last week with the Bell Let's Talk initiative. And you know, we are talking about mental health right now, but I'm not sure if you know, the way we're treating mental health today is the way we treated it 40 years ago, right? It hasn't changed, and it's not working. It's not working for our communities. And so just to get a sense of what's happening, we know 1 in 5 Canadians will suffer from a mental health illness across the span of their lifetime. We also know that 70% of all disability costs are attributed to mental health illnesses. And 500,000 Canadians in any given week are unable to work due to mental health challenges. If unaddressed, the impact of mental health conditions on lost productivity will cost Canadian businesses $198 billion over the next 30 years. It's not about the money, right? We all know somebody who's suffering from a mental health illness and can't get the treatment that they require. And so we want to tackle this in a different way, and we want to bring a new proposal forward. So right now, Algoma University, in partnership with the Sioux Area Hospital, Shingwakinomagegamik, which is one of the 8 Ontario Indigenous Institutes, and the Northern Ontario School of Medicine, has a proposal before the government for an institute for the prevention and treatment of mental illness and addictions. And what we're trying to do is train a new generation of mental health professionals, offering various programming right from certificate to medical training. And our idea, as we talk to 3 institutions, is to eventually expand that north-south link and bring that center to bring the institute to support the Brampton Center for Health and Innovation. The idea, again, around digital health, we know that we can actually reach more people if we use technology and innovation, and we want to explore that, in particular with Ryerson and Sheridan, because they're doing some pretty incredible things on the digital health scene, and have the capacity to really bring and move that piece forward. So the goals around mental health and addictions, we want to link the Institute for the Prevention and Treatment of Mental Health and Addictions with the Health and Cyber Activity in Brampton. We want to come up with a new approach to addressing mental health and addictions by learning from Indigenous ways of knowing and Western science, and sort of bringing those two disciplines together to create a new model for treatment. And we want to link entrepreneurial activity in Brampton and Sault Ste. Marie related to innovation in digital healthcare. So in terms of future plans, possibilities, and opportunities, we're going to have Mohammed wrap up. But I think, you know, from my perspective, it isn't often you get the opportunity to work with three presidents at one time. And it's been an absolute joy to have conversation with these two presidents. We want to make a difference, right? We can see that there are a couple of areas that with some specialization and some real focused effort and bringing our talent together, we can actually achieve something pretty great for the communities that we're serving, Brampton included. And that's really the premise of the proposal, is you've got three presidents here that are very keen to work together to really make a difference. We're not interested in just offering degrees. We actually want to be change makers. And that's what we hope you took from our presentation this evening.
Thank you very much. I will be very brief here. This is about partnership. And I think Asma put it in a very nice way about the partnership between the three institutions. But the most important thing is this partnership is with you, with the City of Brampton, and also with all levels of governance. We can talk a lot about bold ideas, but if we don't get those dreams into reality by getting the necessary support from all levels of governance, we'll be just talking. Yeah. So I think this is very appealing also. We have initiated some discussion with politicians at all levels, and when you talk to them about the importance of solving problems, especially the mental health, reducing the pressure on healthcare in general, addressing the issue of cybersecurity, I can tell you the reaction has been quite positive from all, I'm talking about the provincial and the federal government. And this is probably the only area where the two governments of the day will be able to collaborate. The other aspect that was mentioned by Asma about the corridor north-south, I think the importance of including some learnings from indigenous populations is extremely important, because we have seen actually when we looked at issues that you have in Brampton, in the north, especially with indigenous population, you have very similar issues. The pattern is extremely similar. I know that diabetes here is one of the biggest issues. There's a similar problem with indigenous populations. Same thing with addiction, same thing with mental health. So let's work together to give Brampton this platform to be really a city where we can address challenges, we find solutions, and we get the support from all levels of governments.
Good. You know, I would close by speaking on behalf of the Sheridan community. So those of you who know me would attest that I take very seriously my accountability to the faculty, the staff, and most notably the students at Sheridan. You know, at 42,000 of enrollment, I would want you to hear that this partnership, in my view, builds on existing strength. And so I think it's a good thing for Sheridan. I think it's good for our students. I think it's good for our faculty and our staff. I think the notion of synergy and the collective strength, I think I don't want to speak beyond, but you know, you've got 100 years of experience combined in the post-secondary sector, and all of us in our institutions known for being trailblazing. So this excites me, it excites our learning community, and there's great enthusiasm for, as I say, building on existing strength and together moving forward on behalf of the city and on behalf of the province. So thank you for your time.
Okay, well, thank you, and I know we're going to have a lot of questions. Let me say at the starting point that obviously the City of Brampton has a proud history working with your three institutions, and I think our investments and partnerships in the past speak to the fact that we have a lot of faith in your ability to help young people in our community and to gear them towards employment. And I should just, as we start this conversation, I should mention, if you look at the City of Brampton's past partnerships with Ryerson, June 2019, $5 million over 5 years for the Cybersecurity Catalyst. In January 2020, $5 million over 5 years for the milestone agreement between the City and Ryerson to establish the Ryerson Innovation Zone. With Algoma, the $575,000 in April 2019, the grant to renovate space and upgrade the rear facade of 24 Queen Street East. August 2019, the quite significant $7.3 million over 3 years grant funding to facilitate a planned second phase expansion of Algoma University's academic programming. Sheridan College, the $2.5 million over 5 years when there was we were asked for a contribution to the William G. Davis campus expansion. And so we've been proud to work with your institutions, and I appreciate the fact that you're have taken an interest in our city's aspirations to provide more opportunities for young people. I've had the opportunity to hear this presentation before. I'm many members of council, this is the first time that you're seeing. I know you wanted to have it in a public venue so those in the city could hear what we're hearing as well, that there are serious proposals on the table. And for anyone at home who thought that there was no opportunities for Brampton, we're now seeing that there is a multitude of options, and that's encouraging. A few questions that I asked you in private that I think would be good to ask in public as well. When we first started talking about it, the terminology we used was a med school. So I know there's different words here, but this is, in your interpretation, a form of a modern med school. Is that what you're saying?
That's exactly.
Okay.
Modern medical school for the 21st century that has three pillars. Mm-hmm. The first pillar is the work within the community. Mm-hmm. It's not just to train doctors mm-hmm. to work in hospitals. It's to train doctors really to serve the community. Mm-hmm. The second one is the use of technology. Mm-hmm. I think there are many ways for us to use the technology in our advantage to reduce wait time, but also to serve people in their communities. Mm-hmm. I can tell you we have a partnership with a company in Etobicoke, Mayent. Mayent actually is in the business of textile. They do 3D, very advanced technologies for textile, and they embed it in the way they do it with sensors mm-hmm. to control the how the body is reacting. So in terms of aging population, we know that our country has, of course, we are aging as a country, and having actually the ability of monitoring the behavior of the body of all of us will reduce actually the dependency of us to go to hospitals for any problem. The third aspect of this is about also finding a way to work in a more collaborative way. This is why we are talking about all the professions together to try to address the issue of health. It's not just the medical doctors, it's also the support system around it and make sure that we are the 21st century medical school. When we met with the mayor, actually we went recently to Ryan University in New Jersey. It's a university that has transformed downtown. The downtown area, but also brought two medical schools of the 21st century. We were extremely, my team is with me here, we spent the whole day there. The way that they come up with transforming the downtown area, but also making sure that to bring two medical schools to address all the issues of the region. And we have many examples of people who are challenging the status quo in terms of healthcare and bringing solutions to the healthcare problem. Matt, also you asked probably terminology that we are using. We have no problem calling this Brampton Medical School. We can put in there this powered by Ryerson or by any other institution, but I think this is about Brampton, not about us.
And the context on that is I'd ask the question, is this Algoma, is this Sheridan, is it Ryerson? You said that it would be in your presentation, which it which it is. I guess my question is, I know there's going to be a lot of questions. Obviously, any community would be excited to welcome a med school, but we're also in an environment of fiscal austerity at Queen's Park. They're dealing with a very challenging debt. So how many, you know, how many physicians, how many family physicians? I know there would be lots of other programs that would be offered through the three institutions, but do you have a ballpark of how many physicians you think the province would allow you to train, knowing that there's some goals to have cost containment within the healthcare system?
This is why, actually, I wanted to give two numbers. Yeah. The number of family physicians per capita in Canada, 2.7, compared to, as I said, in the top 10 countries with wealth, we are in the bottom. And the other thing is the reference today about what are the needs, the immediate needs for the province in the last next five years, the shortage in terms of medical doctors in Ontario for the next 5 years is 8,000. Mm-hmm. And in terms of nurses is 20,000. Mm-hmm. So one thing that we discussed here, we didn't want to put any number. It's easy for us to come and talk to you about a big dream of a huge presence here, out of respect also for the governments that are going normally to support this. I think this is about a conversation that we have to have with you, with the provincial government, and eventually with the federal government. We have to be very realistic. We understand the challenges, the fiscal situation, but also the need for professionals in the area. So we didn't want to put a number without talking to the government. Tell you, out of respect for that, it's important to get them as partners here. It's easy for us to go and say that we need a medical school for the shortage of 8,000. Let's try to address this in the next 5 years. But I think we have to be realistic, but also respectful, I mean, to the council here, but also to the provincial
committee. Yeah, I think it's fair to say you can call it a med school if you're graduating physicians. I think one worry would be that you're building a med school and then the province says, okay, we don't want more physicians because it's too expensive, and then all of a sudden it's not really a med school. But you feel confident that, you know, there would be support for that?
So if I can just offer, yeah. I think in our collective experience, the conversations that we've had, and this makes good sense to all of you who run your own businesses, This is about the value proposition on enrollment.
Yeah.
And I can speak on behalf of Sheridan when I say that, notwithstanding that the demography of Ontario right now does not support expanded post-secondary, what it supports is a shift in enrollment towards in-demand programs based on economic and labor need. Mm-hmm. And I think all three of us have experience and a track record of success in moving the government when we see a need to pivot. And so, you know, building on the strengths of Algoma and Ryerson, what we have is a practical nursing program. Mm-hmm. Okay, we need to educate more of those nurse professionals. We need a venue for them to be experientially trained and engaged in communities. This is a mechanism for further promoting our degree in health promotion. So we think the value proposition, building on the synergistic relationship between all three organizations and the leverage we can bring to the table, it is actually likely to succeed. We have confidence in our capacity to advocate and use our individual and institutional leverage to advocate with the city towards a shared goal.
Well, I would never underestimate Mohammed Lashmi's ability to pull out a rabbit out of a hat.
Yeah.
No one in Ontario was saying we needed more lawyers, but he got a law school approved. We're interested and we're asking questions, but obviously the city has precious resources, the provinces has precious resources, and that's why I'm sure there's going to be some tough questions tonight, but it's out of the best interest of the community. So on that note, Councillor...
Can I just add one piece? Yeah. Because if we go to existing medical schools, the response would be easy. We don't need more medical schools. I mean, that's... We know that. Your point about law school, 4 or 5 years ago when we started the conversation, everybody was saying that we don't need another law school, we don't need more lawyers. We started this by approaching it in a very different way, and this is exactly what we want to do here. We need a different type of medical school. That's the message that we have been using in 4 or 5 years with the law school, by integration of experiential learning, aspect of innovation and using of innovation, but also opening the door for everybody, so in terms of access to justice. And I give you just because our medical law school is starting in September. When we finish all the process, we went to the law society. They saw the curriculum that we are proposing. And you know that when you, I mean, your background is law. When you do a medical, when you do a law degree, you have 3 years, and then you do articling. When they saw what we are doing, because of the innovation, the law society decided that Ryerson students, when they finish the 3 years, they don't need articling, it's already incorporated. So basically, in terms of saving, instead of spending 4 years, you spend 3 years. And everything is integrated. So that's the innovation that we have put in place. We are accepting in September 150 students, new students, for a new law school that nobody actually was expecting. We have more than 2,000 applicants.
On that note, we have, I think, most counselors that are on the board. Councilor Medeiros.
First of all, thank you, Mayor, for using the power of the chair to ask many of my questions and not opening the floor. So that shows how tactfully you're ready. Now, thank you very much to the presidents. And again, I think, you know, when I consider the presentation, I'm curious about the motivation. You know, one thing I think, President, you talked about, you know, we hear the Premier talking about improving outcomes, labor attachment, labor market outcomes. So there seems to be, so obviously there is that alignment. So when I consider all this, this is all great things. Who would say no? Now, in terms of identifying our role as a municipality, in terms of, you know, what is the ask? And that seems to be, you know, not to simplify it, And I know this isn't a massage, you know, to have three presidents here, executives lining up. We know this is important, but we need to know what is the ask. Is it about we're looking for some capital funding to join, to build an innovation center? You know, we talk about, and we seem we've gone in different directions in the last couple of years. So I think to this council, you know, for us to be able to understand our role in this exciting vision, what specifically is the ask?
Sorry, we started by saying this is a conversation with you. And I think it's not appropriate for us from day one to come up with an ask. First of all, we have ideas. We are putting those ideas to council. And we can start that conversation. Mayor asked about the size. I think that would depend also about this. But we need also to have the same conversation with the government. And out of respect, we did not want to have this type of presentation. We have started quite discussion with government, but we wanted, of course, we're talking about Brampton. Brampton playing a major role in this. It's very important for us to see how do you see this. Do you like the vision that we are presenting? And you can see here that we have presenting the vision in different areas. Yeah. Are those areas important for council and for City of Brampton? And in this case, we can start that conversation. We understand the limited resources that municipal government, provincial government, federal government has. But I think it's important for us also to look at other opportunities. How can we get support for such innovation in almost three sectors? So, sorry for not putting any number, but I think it's important for us to have that more discussion and see what's the reaction from council to those ideas.
And, yeah. and I think just to follow up on what Mohammed's saying as well, we have a lot of the infrastructure in place already with some of the degree programs. So both the college and the university have health science programs. Ryerson has a number of health science programs as well. So a lot of those foundational pieces are there, and we've been talking about, you know, what would we do to those existing programs so they could ladder into higher level programming, like programming that would happen in medical school. But the other piece that seems to be gaining traction and is of great interest is the whole piece around revolutionizing, right? Innovation in healthcare and using technology in new and really creative ways so that our patients aren't getting stuck in emergency and, you know, this whole piece around hallway healthcare. That it's not just the government that's talking about fixing that. I mean, communities are asking for it, us to do something to fix this. And so
through the mayor, the only question I would ask, so we talk about, say, you know, for a simplified term, a med school. Well, a med school, you know, having professionals graduate for it doesn't guarantee that these folks are going to stay in our community. But if there's no funding for William Osler from the province, then we're basically training all these folks and they're going to be going out to other communities where they'll have those funding dollars. But maybe you can speak to the spillover impact. Again, I've never lived in a city where there's a medical school. And I think for us to understand, notwithstanding the ability from promotional perspective to say we have a med school right here in the city of Brampton, I'm sure there's spillover impact in the community. So just very, you know, concisely, if you can maybe mention, because you talked about the collaboration, William Osler, et cetera, et cetera. You know, how would that be an impetus for us to address some of our healthcare needs, which we declared an emergency, and at the same time, having that sort of economic spinoff?
So I worked at a med school for a long time, and or for a while. And I, you know, what I would say is that the med school of the future is not about training docs. And so, you know, what we've tried to present is a commitment to allied health. And so augmenting and increasing, intensifying the education that surrounds medical health professions, plural. And so I think, you know, you think about health sciences and having looked at enrollment data from, for example, Ryerson and York and U of T and Sheridan and Humber, students from Brampton are pursuing health sciences all over the place. So if we think about health sciences programming at a different level, cascading or laddering into actual medical training, there's a whole lot that comes from that in terms of enrollment. I'd also, you know, build on Ozma's comments about innovation. We, all three of us, are research intensive. And so, to the point of funding, I wouldn't just think about this as being funded by governments through transfer payments. You know, we talked about the Center for Mobile Innovation, we talked about the Catalyst. Those are actually funded in large measure by research dollars and by grant dollars, and in many instances by industry partnerships. And so I think our collective experience in bringing together funders around shared goals and objectives speaks really highly to the power of the partnership. Do you want to say something else?
The piece of research is important here. To have a medical school, you need a platform, hospital. And the proposal that we have here, I think it's natural to have the William Osler Hospital as the platform for this medical school. So when we talk about the platform, the aspect of research is very powerful. I can tell you, when you look at the research dollars in universities, the universities that are getting the most research dollars is because of medical research. So the idea here is not, of course, we are talking about a level of enrollment that we need to discuss with the government, but those research dollars that are in millions of dollars will be spent here on the community, because you need, this is why the focus that we want is on the community. You have issues that are very specific to the region. So when you bring those research dollars will be spent here on the community. And you attract, in this case, more researchers to the area. And we are seeing that in all the hospitals in downtown Toronto. Actually, in terms of research dollars, you see their reports every year. They bring a lot of money that is, of course, spent in the downtown area. I think having this as an association with William Osler will really be the platform to do also the research part.
Yeah, and thank you, Mayor. Before I see we have a long line, just very quickly, and it was touched upon, I see when you see this powerful relationship, the ability to leverage and engage with stakeholders from all different sectors, bring people to the table. When we talk about collaboration, all the, you know, the other day I was with a group from the Vietnamese community that want to build a seniors home here. And I thought it was a traditional seniors home. I met with them and they were talking about artificial intelligence. They're talking about
technology.
So, and they mentioned Sheridan. They mentioned why they're interested in coming to Brampton, the ability. So when you see that powerful engagement, and now we're looking at working with this type of, you know, this type of collaboration, you know, I'm interested in continuing this conversation, if that's the ask. You've perked my interest. Certainly, I know staff, you know, we've heard a lot of these sort of priority areas for the last, since I've been here at council, life sciences, innovation, you know, the buzzwords, and you seem to have encapsulated everything in a very neat presentation, which is very powerful. So I thank you very much for coming here, and certainly I look forward to, I guess, future conversations, but I thank you.
Next up, Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Chair, thank you so much. It's great to see the three of you together collaborating. It's fantastic. And totally support the collaboration, as Councillor Majeros had said. And it sounds like we're looking at some programming, some new types of programming, and certainly your collaboration together can bring that forward, you know, regardless of what we say, you can continue to do that together. The other thing I wanted to ask is specifically around competing universities, talking about medical schools. I know that York, once upon a time, was looking into medical school. Waterloo's interested in medical school. There's a lot of competition and talk about medical schools. How do you deal with that? And more specifically, how do you combat that if, in explaining what a new medical school of the future is going to look like? And how much time is that going to take to figure out? Because right now it sounds like an innovation, health innovation center that will eventually become a medical school over time. So, you know, I'm happy to continue the conversation, but just wondering how long the conversation is going to take.
Yeah, so it's a good question. And I think, you know, the imperative there is on value proposition and is on capitalizing on momentum. And, you know, I would share that I was involved in drafting the ask for York. Folks will know that I came from York and I was leading in the Faculty of Health, and we put forward a proposal for a medical school, so I'm familiar with that space. I would suggest to you that the business argument for positioning an innovative medical school of the future is very viable in Brampton, but it's going to rest on the value proposition. And I think, to Mohammed's point, there's an opportunity here to build on momentum around what is otherwise happening in healthcare and the demographics of Brampton. I think if we pull together a whole bunch of different pressing issues, and combine that with the leverage and the influence of the three organizations, it's our hope that will, in the end, win the day.
I can give you a number. I hope that this will not be included in the minutes.
You're on camera.
It's a public meeting.
No. Look at the political situation, both provincially and federally. We'll most likely have an election or elections in the same year, provincially and federally. This is the window of time that we think at Ryerson we can get a medical school approved for granted, maximum 2 years and a half.
So do you have the support from your various boards already?
I have been discussing this with our board. And I can tell you from our perspective, and we had the discussion when we started the discussion here in Brampton about the importance of doing things. Our board is always asking me about one thing, and that is the reputation of the university. Having a medical school of the 21st century will add a lot to the reputation of our university, and I don't speak on behalf of other universities, but I think this is exactly the same situation. And I can tell you that having a medical school in the 905 area will really address the needs of the populations that are from different communities in this state. So I have had a discussion with our board, and they're excited about the opportunity.
And I can share with you as well, our focus with our board has been on the mental health and addictions side of the portfolio, but very, very interested in moving forward and supporting that piece. The other thing that I will share with you is, for me, it's about that holistic look at health in the city and ensuring that as we create this vision around healthcare, that we're doing so in a holistic way, that we're taking students as soon as they come, actually I would say even earlier, when they're in grade 9, 10, and 11, and getting them excited about healthcare, health innovation, ensuring that they know what kinds of jobs are out there in the healthcare fields, because our undergraduate programs are expanding. People are very interested in health and health innovation. And there are many, many job opportunities besides the doctor. You know, everyone that comes into grade 9, they want to be a doctor or a lawyer. But by the time they start moving through the health training, they change their minds and they realize, oh no, I wanted to actually go into this, or I wanted to go, and they're good jobs, and they're important jobs. So as we're designing this vision, I guess I would just ask that we think really holistically, because it's going to require everyone from that first-year college student to that fourth-year degree to the master's and the PhD. Everyone is part of the change that's got to happen in healthcare.
So I have absolutely had this conversation with Sheridan's board. We are all about trailblazing, and our new strategic plan certainly rests on two important pillars, and they are partnerships and community engagement. And to the extent that this partnership will drive not just Sheridan's academic, but its strategic objectives, and of significant note, I think further positions us as an anchor institution in Brampton, our board is fully supportive and excited about the opportunity.
The other thing about this proposal that I don't think is anywhere else in the province, and maybe not the country, is to have three organizations coming together in partnership and a north-south link. We haven't seen anything like it, and so positioning an ask that really meets the needs of Ontario, but is a more of a holistic approach to solving some pretty significant problems, and doing that in partnership as three institutions with varying partners, communities, hospitals, I think that puts us in a unique position as well.
That's great. So through you, Chair, so a lot of conversations are happening. That's good to know. And we're working towards a level of support from the three institutions. And is just for clarification, would this be certificate or degree programming?
All of the above.
All certificate and degree programming.
And reskilling.
And reskilling.
Opportunities.
Okay. That's really good to know. And again, I think I had already asked this question in terms of how long it would take. Mohammed, you had mentioned 2 years?
I'm just giving you the kind of the framework for the political situation. And I think it's important for us as institutions, but also to work with the city of Brampton, but also to work with governments to address the needs. Because at the end of the day, it's not just asking for a new institution or a new medical school. I think we have to provide the governments, all levels of government, with solutions. Because at the end, it will be a win-win situation. We just, I don't think that going to the government asking for a new idea with an X number of students will get us to what we want. Let's try to work together to find a solution to the issues that we are facing as society. And the timing, as I said, I'm talking about the framework in which we have two governments, both here in Toronto and in Ottawa. I think we have a good framework where we can have this conversation with both levels of government.
Yes, absolutely. And would this proposal be dependent on our advocacy efforts for another hospital as well?
I think this is either to have another hospital or have expansion of existing hospitals, this would be integrated as part of the solution.
Okay.
I just wanted to clarify that there's some things in this proposal that can happen a lot more quickly than two years that are actually in training now. So there's stuff in collaboration and in partnership on, you know, leveraging the expertise of Algoma on indigenous learning, for example, or thinking about leveraging our cybersecurity programming at the undergraduate and graduate level. That stuff's happening already and I think doesn't need a runway.
Master's programming, we're already moving through our system.
Right.
We know we want Sheridan feeding into our master's program.
Thank you. And my one last question, because I see a long lineup. I'm sorry, guys. Through you, Chair. So there would be, like, Algoma, Virus, and Sheridan would be willing to provide funding and support for this?
I mean, that's part of the discussion that we want to have.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Vicente.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you so much for coming today. I can tell you that there are folks seated in the chamber today. I know from conversations with them, they're very excited about the prospect of having a medical school. So when you talk about designing a new type of medical school that is geared or designed from the ground up to meet the needs of the community and of the industry as a whole, what kind of conversations have you had with some of the main organizations, for example, the College of Physicians or the College of Nurses, to try to, before you embark, have some idea of how it is that you can achieve that?
Let me say that the discussion that we have had, first of all, is with our partners, because we at Ryerson have a number of hospitals that we are partnering with. And we have been actually bringing the innovation aspect to that partnership. We have an innovation hub, biomedical zone, that is located within St. Mark's Hospital. And the idea is really also to bring technology, because we are bringing our engineers, our scientists to work with clinicians. And it's an institute for collaboration, but beside that, you have an innovation hub to give opportunities for people to take their ideas to market. It has been an extremely positive experience. And when we talk to a number of partners, they're very keen to really explore possibilities for a new way of offering education and training for medical doctors. We have not approached the college of any colleges because in terms of accreditation, actually, to get a medical school, it's a North American body to do the accreditation process. I don't think it's appropriate for us to engage them in the discussion without engaging you, because this is a proposal that we want to have with the city of Brampton, and I think it's not appropriate for us to engage people from outside without having this conversation that we have tonight.
Okay, thank you. You spoke in your presentation about offering certificate, diploma program, degrees, but you also mentioned the idea that one could move through to the higher levels through master's degree and PhD. Are you saying that that would happen here in the city of Brampton, or would they have to go to other schools?
No, I mean, the idea is that everything happens in Brampton. So they come into our programming right out of high school. They start in a degree program, whether it's at the college or the university. And then they move through to master's, which we already are in the process of bringing forward in clinical psychology, and social work is the other one that we're looking at. But the idea then is they can ladder into a medical school. So if we have a medical school in Brampton, the idea is to be feeding from Brampton into that medical school to keep our young people here.
Okay, thank you. I had a question about will it require investment, but you've answered that already, so I defer my time. Thank you.
Councillor Bowman.
Thank you very much, through you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you very much for coming. It's a pleasure to see all of you here together, as has been echoed by this council already. And your numbers for people who have graduated from Sheridan who are working at the city include one additional as well. So I'm just wondering, this is a great collaboration. What was the impetus to get you guys to collaborate?
We've been collaborating with Algoma and Ryerson for a long, like for as long as I've been at Sheridan. So I would just remind council that this is not net new for Sheridan. We have partnership agreements with other colleges and universities, not just in the province, but international partnerships. And so I think this is just building on existing very positive experiences. I'll also speak to the fact that 30 years in the sector, this is a partnership that is strong and I think grounded in reciprocity and equity. So, my colleagues and I feel like we are a respected partner in this triad. And I think that's what differentiates it and gives it tremendous strength. These are three strong, individual, unique organizations that are bringing strength to the table, and we all work from a strength-based perspective. And so I think that's serving the collective purpose.
I would just add that the first proposal that was funded by the previous government was actually about Sheridan-Ryerson collaboration here. So I would say this is not new, but we are also actually trying to address the issue of more efficiency in the system. I think this is going to be very appealing to the government because governments, all levels of government, are always under huge pressure from all institutions for more resources. I think by working together, we are also about creating opportunities for more meaningful partnership, but also optimization of resources.
And thank you, Mohammed, because I think that's a big point, that you guys already have various courses taking place in your colleges and university that you're finding a way to merge, to come to a common goal, which is what we're looking for. So I really like that. The Indigenous aspect is something that, Asma, when you came here, first of all, there was a number of people on council that were very interested in that. And to be able to work with and possibly have an exchange, not only of ideas and of courses, but of what's going on up there, what's going on down here in terms of addictions, in terms of mental health, and an exchange of ideas, I think that's going to be a turning point for both. So I like the idea about the North and South, and I would love to see sort of an Indigenous exchange take place between the universities here. As far as the type of student or the locale of the student, would your focus be on local students? I know everybody says at the beginning, our university is going to be for local students, but there's always the lure of that international student that pays more, that you make more profit on. Mm-hmm. Can you comment on that?
I'll comment about Ryerson, and I'm sure my colleagues will add more to this. Actually, the areas that we want to focus are areas of extremely important for our domestic students, but also because of the need for talent. Our university, as I mentioned at the beginning, has 45,000 students. We are one of the few universities with a very low percentage of international students. We have this year 7% of international students. 93% of our students are domestic students. And the other thing that is very important in the context of Ryerson, we serve the GTA. More than 80% of our students are from GTA. So there's a huge demand for us. Of course, the international part of it is important in terms of the fiscal situation of universities, but I would say that there is a huge demand. And I would say if we want to start a medical school here, that would be for local students. Why? Because we have hundreds of students and a lot of families that are sending their kids elsewhere to get medical education. You have a lot of people going to the UK, Ireland, Scotland, the US, the Caribbeans. Why we don't retain them here? And actually what they're paying is much higher than what our local students are paying here in other medical schools.
Okay, thank you. Just a couple more points here. We've talked about the importance of cybersecurity, and I think we've just seen with Blood Labs and other incidents that have happened, the need. Medicine is moving more and more and more to E. Your records are on E. Your results from your tests, your X-rays are sent. Your diagnostic imaging, it's all sent via computers and via the cloud. So the importance of merging cybersecurity seems very important to me. And I don't think you need to comment on that. I think it's self-evident. But I don't think that is really being taken into a big focus here. That the courses that you've talked about here are a natural progression with what is actually happening in the medical world right now. So I like that. Now, final question, can somebody comment on the potential for economic development and investment if this were to happen in Brampton in terms of research laboratories, in terms of specialization, in terms of aging in place studies? Can somebody comment on the possibility?
I can tell you that, and I think one of the other questions was also related about what's the impact of having a medical school here. I think the impact would be major in terms of the local hospitals here. And also the other thing that will be very unique, with a medical school here associated with William Osler, you will be able to attract top-notch medical doctors to work here and specialists, because they're also looking for them opportunities where they can continue to learn and discover. So the discovery aspect is very important. And we know the difference in the GTA between hospitals that they have affiliation with a medical school and hospitals they don't have. I think that could be very significant here. The research aspect, as I said, look at hospitals in downtown Toronto that are bringing those research funding in the millions and millions. The economic impact is significant in that aspect. And it's not just about the training of a number of students in the thing, but also you have research centers that are associated with, I would say that the areas that of interest here for Brampton, you will have also ability to attract world-class researchers that will bring also more money and also more people to work in the area. So I think it's going to be very significant. I just mentioned the example of Rowan University in New Jersey. We visited them, they have two medical schools. The impact on the city is very significant, and I would invite any of you to go and visit and see by yourselves and ask those type of questions.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you all very much for coming here.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you very much for coming. It was exciting to listen to the passion that you've brought forward, and exciting to hear about kind of the different ways and thinking for the disease of the brain that we classify as mental health and addictions. I'm always intrigued as to a different way of trying to combat this illness. And like you said, haven't done really anything about it in over 40 years, and we're not thinking about any different ways of doing it. Not that I hear of, anyways. We just kind of throw pills at it, I guess, and hope that it goes away, and it's not. It's getting worse. So anytime that I hear if there's opportunities, then I'm certainly supportive of that. I disagree with our current state of healthcare here in Brampton. It's one thing to say, coming out of maybe Toronto or other municipalities, that more beds isn't really the answer when you have double the number of beds that Brampton has. We're in a crisis. We're not even at the state of any other cities that are around us. And it'd be easy, I'd be the first one to say maybe beds aren't the answer when we have the beds, to be able to say that, but right now we don't have the beds. International students So you say that Ryerson has 7% international students. What's that relate to for the enrollment? How many?
It's 3,000 out of 45,000.
3,000.
The total number of students that we have at Ryerson, 45,000, and 3,000 are international.
And how many enrollments do you get? Sorry, how many applications do you get to go to Ryerson from international students?
Oh, I don't know exactly. About 10,000? 10 to 1. So the ratio of applications to sports that are available is 10 to 1.
So you only allow the 3,000 into? Okay.
I think it's fair because we have huge demand from domestic students. Mm-hmm. We don't want to display space that should go to domestic students and replaced by international students. We have actually planned to increase a little bit international student population, but not at the expense of domestic students.
Mm-hmm. And I like that idea and I like that thought, because obviously you want the more international students you're bringing in, then the less money that anybody else is kicking to the expansions and the programmings. And speaking of which, the money, and I know we're not talking money here today, you know, I've always kind of said it from the beginning when we went down this endeavor last term, I'm not sure what you know, the municipality's role in a university in their municipality is. I don't know what role Waterloo played. I don't know what role Guelph played, or I just don't know. And yet we seem to be always having the conversation about a university in Brampton. Do we want a university in Brampton? Sure, we do. But it's kind of out of our power, or out of our control, and yet we still tend to cough up a little bit of the taxpayers' money to try and get us to where we want to go. I like the thought of the three of you, especially Sheridan being a pillar in this community, at the table. And I think, I'm assuming that the partnership is going to set up a board for something like this when we, you know, do get it up and running and going. Is that kind of the way it'll?
I think we have to find the structure to do it. We're not there yet, but that's part of the discussion with the institutions.
We all live within governance frameworks that will need to be navigated.
Mm-hmm.
There are good examples out there, though, of institutions that have done that. So the Northern Ontario School of Medicine has partnership with Laurentian and Lakehead. So those three work together, and they share Senate and governance, and then they have their own governance model as well. So there's lots of examples out there of things that we can be looking at.
Okay. And so how does the, I guess, and I'm not 100% familiar on what this pivot or innovative way of you know, rethinking this education system is going to look like. But what, sorry, I lost my train of thought there. No, I might have to come back to me.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you, for coming and presenting this to us. But I keep thinking, why now? Why not like months ago? Because this is so great. You know what I mean? Like, I know, right?
Yeah.
I know, and you have been having these conversations, but I think for the public and for some of us here, it seems like very more new information, right? And But it's great to see this collaboration, and it's important. And so thank you for coming in and giving us this information. One of the things we know, many of us here in Brampton, is that residents want a university. They want post-secondary. But why are they saying that? And the question I ask is, you know, yeah, when I ask why they're saying it, I keep thinking, well, maybe they just don't realize that there are three post-secondary options here in the city of Brampton, and highly reputable ones. And so I wonder how much, moving forward, how much more are you going to invest in making sure every single corner of Brampton they know that there are great options for post-secondary here in the city.
So I can respond to some of the things that we're doing at the school board. We are engaging in pretty serious conversations with Peel District School Board, Peel Catholic District School Board, about projects we can be doing together, building those relationships, building that trust. There's been a lot of excitement about some of the new programs that are being offered right now. And I think some of it is, you know, just getting signage off the ground and building that presence. I mean, Sheridan is a pillar in the community. Everybody Absolutely. Knows about Sheridan. Not everybody knows about Algoma, and there are a lot of questions about Ryerson, right? Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, that's something that we have to continue to work on, but it's coming slowly but surely.
And that's good to hear. I think once the news of, you know, the province pulling the funding away, you know, it really deflated everybody's expectations, and then it left people feeling like there's no, that's it, we've got nothing.
Can I just suggest, Councillor, I think the other piece of this is that people are looking for, in my conversations with residents, they're looking for what they know, which mm-hmm. is bricks, mortar, university, right? And probably ivy on the walls and, you know, maybe a steeple or something in the middle. Mm-hmm. And I think this is really challenging us because in those same conversations, when I say, you know, what are the aspirations that you have for your son or daughter, it's typically about employment, it's about earning potential, it's about sustainable employment, and there's a piece of there around identity, right? Mm-hmm. I want my kid to be engaged in a profession. And so when I then say, okay, Sheridan's got this wide array of degree programs, people are like, what? Like, mm-hmm. I thought it was diplomas and certificates. We do a bunch of stuff in partnership with other universities. The university that I attended is not the university of tomorrow or a decade away, and I think all of our institutions are evolving. And so some of the challenge that we're talking about is how do you rebrand what we're doing around the collective power mm-hmm. of learning communities to meet learner needs. No one institution anymore may be equipped to deal with 42,000 individual learning plans or aspirations. So how do you make sure that you're providing options for residents, their families, learners? And we think this collaboration does that.
It does. It answers a lot of the questions that people have and provides solutions. And it's exciting, you know, especially knowing how Brampton's healthcare system, where we're at with it, you know, the thought of a top class, you know, a learning facility is exciting. You know, you see what it's done for Western University. It's known for their medical practices. And, you know, I really do appreciate the North-South connection. I went to Ryerson, and I my professor, Judy Finley, she brought some of the students to some of the reserves in the North-South partnership. And that was a great opportunity. I didn't go because my son was very little at the time. But, you know, it really does give a different perspective on that holistic learning and understanding the impacts that housing has on suicide rates and sexual abuse, and being able to really target some of those key stressors that individuals are going through. So it's great that Algoma, you're going to be able to provide that, and you know, I'm really excited about the partnership. So, you know, is there opportunity, and I'm just throwing this out there, is there opportunity for you to look at the possibility of having Brampton branded on some of your certificates and the, you know, the diplomas that are handed out? Because, you know, that also helps to really highlight the fact that there are three major post-secondary options, you know, Algoma, Brampton on a person's diploma that they receive at their graduation, to show that we are so closely connected and that they got their studies from here in the city. Just throwing that out there.
Just saying, the Davis name is on all of our parchment, and if we're changing that, somebody else better call them. So, yes, we're very proud of that affiliation, and Patrick, the mayor can call him. But I think those are the kinds of things we got to think about, right? How do we wrap this? What does it look like? How do you make it digestible? How do you make it real for people? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I hope what you hear is a commitment to further dialogue and discussion about what it needs to look like to meet Absolutely. The municipal, the regional, the provincial needs that are in front of us.
The other piece of it too is how the community can help us market what we actually have in Brampton. So earlier we talked about 28 undergraduate degrees, 30 up to 30 degrees that we can bring, already bringing six, right? The degree potential for Ryerson in the future in Brampton. So there's already a huge base for students to stay local. Mm-hmm. And I think marketing that whole stay local and are you aware of what's in your own community, right up to the master's level, mm-hmm. Is gonna be an important piece to work together on. I will share with you, our branding is Algoma U Brampton now. So mm-hmm. when you see our new signs and things, we do say an Algoma U student is an Algoma U student. We want to have those same values and things like that. But yes, we've got Brampton in the name.
That's good to hear. So I really appreciate the mm-hmm. the conversation, and I don't think it should ever stop. And, you know, I'm confident that you have doors that are open that want to continue having the conversation here at this table, and just looking at how we can strengthen post-secondary options here in the Brampton, because that is ultimately what residents want. You know, parents want to have that local option for their kids. They want to know that they don't have to pay fees to in you know residents, so
yeah. Yeah.
and meal cards and everything,
yeah.
you name it. So I appreciate you coming out. This is, it's exciting, and I want to see where this goes.
Last but not least, Councillor Doug Williams.
Thank you, through you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for coming in, all three of you. It should be noted, I guess, and I think Councillor Medeiros alluded to this earlier, the conversations have already started with all three of your facilities. It started a number of years ago. It's nice, your vision's clear to me. We built our Peel Memorial Center for Integrated Health and Wellness. It was built on the premises of a new model of healthcare in Brampton. And this is following that model. It aligns nicely with it. It's gonna bring private sector into it. It's gonna bring a lot of good things to Brampton. It aligns very nicely with what we wanna see. I know Councilor Pelleschi mentioned beds, and beds are important, but it's keeping people out of the hospital that's important, and obviously through innovation and through technology and through what you want to do, a new way of healthcare, a new model is certainly piques the interest. So as Councilor Medeiros mentioned too, I'm very interested in continuing on the conversations with this model of a university in Brampton. So thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you, members of council, for all the great questions. Thank you for taking the time on a Monday night. Let me say it's not easy to coordinate the schedules of three busy university presidents who have lots of obligations, but I'm glad everyone had the opportunity to hear from you. We have a motion from Councillor Pelleschi, seconded by Councillor Santos, that the following presentation, actually, can we do the public question period first? No, okay. That the following presentation to the special council meeting of February 3rd, 2020 be received. And that's the presentation from Asma Vesna, Mohammed Lashmi, and Janet Morrison. All those in favor? Motion carries. That takes us to the public question period, and you're welcome to take a seat. I've been standing for an hour and 45 minutes. Good workout tonight. For public question period, this is where we invite members of the public to come forward to the podium and ask any questions about any decision made at council today. The only decision we made was to receive the presentation. Are there any members of the public that would like to ask a question? And if you could state your name for the record.
Ajab Goyet.
Okay. What's your question, Azad?
Mayor, thanks. I want to thank all of you. I don't know what we are talking here about our local grown Brampton University or a collaborative university. And what would be the faith of our Brampton U advocacy campaign? First, I want to thank you, all the friends of Brampton, Ryerson, Algoma, and Sheridan. Thanks, Dr. Mohammed et al. For bringing your proposal for health and innovation hub. I'm here to speak on behalf of fellow 650,000 plus residents of Brampton, that we don't need just Brampton Center for Health and Innovation Hub. What Brampton needs, let me see. With a being a wise of 650,000 plus residents, Brampton needs full medical school. What we need is full medical school and not just a health and innovation hub. Our great friend Ryerson must work for presenting and talking full medical school in Brampton. We are the ninth largest city in Canada and the youngest city in Canada. We deserve not less than the medical school. Please respect Brampton and Bramptonian and come up with full medical school.
Okay. Thank you, Azad. I think that's more of a comment than a question, and the clerk has advised me we do need to keep it to a question. So do you want to wrap up the last sentence with a question?
So I'm just requesting, it's my request to bring with a medical school in Brampton, because Brampton deserves a full medical school. Because if we will produce the doctors here, they can serve the needs of the local residents, the provincial, and the federal population. Brampton population is growing. Provincial population is growing. Immigration is coming up. So population is growing and growing and growing. So the full medical school project is viable, and we need the medical school in Brampton.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I'll take that as a comment rather than a question. Thank you, Azad.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions from the public? Seeing none, we'll move to the confirming bylaw. Our next item of business, item 8, confirming bylaw. I have a motion from Councillor Dillon, seconded by Councillor Willens, to approve the confirming bylaw to confirm the proceedings and decisions from this meeting. All those in favor? Motion carries. Our last item of business is adjournment. Council is next scheduled to meet on Wednesday, February 5th, Wednesday, February 26th, and we also have a double meeting that day because we have the budget approval. I have a motion from Councillor Dillon, seconded by Councillor Willens, to adjourn. All those in favor? Motion carries.